Welcome back to part 8. Now, paint. Finally, we got there in the end, but we're here. So, we're going to start throwing paint at this thing with reckless abandon. You can see that it's just been sort of dusted with a light coat of white primer. That is purely so the base coats don't have to be laid on really thick to cover the grey primer underneath it. So, I wasn't too careful with the white coverage. It's quite spotty, quite patchy, but that doesn't matter. In fact, it's probably going to help us. I'll get into that in a minute. But a quick word about the paint scheme for this thing. Now, this is not going to be the golden, pearly, beautiful, sparkly, five colour pearlescent paint scheme that Paul Olsen did for the motion picture. This is going to be the Enterprise A, not the refit, and it's going to be the Enterprise A specifically as it was in Star Trek 6. So my paint tones are going to be very muted. There's not going to be anything of the pearlescent paint scheme at all. It's just going to be off whites and a few blue grey panels here and there, and muted subtlety is the key for this one. So I've done some paint testing on the other saucer part that I've got from the donor kit that the customer supplied for this build, and I'll drop these in here and just give you a quick rundown of the method of painting it. So basically, you start off with the white base coat as it is now, sort of primer, and you just give a little bit of shading around some of the panel lines. Now, this is a technique that's called pre-shading, and a lot of tank and plane model builders use this method to create the illusion of shadows and stuff like that in small scale models and stuff like that. But in this particular case, what I'm using it for isn't pre-shading, it's just to add random gradients and color variations in the base coats and subsequent top coats as they go on. So as you spray the base coat, you're not trying to bomb the color over so thickly that it destroys and completely covers the pre-shading underneath. You'll get that showing through. Then you apply some masks, in this case the Aztec masks for the main pattern. Then you spray your secondary coat, which in this case is the lighter of the two hull coats and the main hull coat. And then when you remove all the masking, what you've got there is actually two main colours, but with a lot of variation in the saturation of the colours. So you get a lot of variance and sort of a mottled effect over the hull. But that's a real quick way of getting loads of different subtle variations between the shades and panels. And then you just go over again with more like smaller breakup masks, and you pick out odd squares here and there. And there, I'll be using a couple of different blues and grey tones. And then in the end, you just sort of blast it all over with a mix of the top coat, whichever one you like. I'll use the lighter one of the two, the main hull, and you just sort of mist over that until you knock all of the contrast right back until you get really nice subtle shades, and you end up with something that looks pretty much in line with how it looked in Star Trek 6, because I think that's it. On the whole, that's how ILM repainted the ship when they got hold of it for Star Trek 2 and then for the subsequent films. So I'll get into painting this thing and I'll show you a few of the steps as we go along. So the first stage is going to be just picking out some of these panel lines just at random, no rhyme or reason. Just I'll get some black paint in the airbrush and just start tracing over some of these lines, not all of them, but just some of them, and then we'll take it from there and see what's what. So let's get the airbrush out. It's about time, isn't it? Let's start chucking some paint at this thing. You can see I've got a really nice expensive airbrush here. I think it came with an old compressor I bought. Probably buy these things for like 30-40 quid. Serves me fine. I ain't trying to sign my name or create fine art with it, so no need to spend like hundreds of pounds on an airbrush. This one will do fine. Right, so here we go. I'm just going to start here. Like I said earlier, I'm not being precious about this. I'm not trying to follow the lines exactly. I'm just picking out random ones. No rhyme or reason. I'm not even trying to follow the lines that closely anyway. There we go. Granted, it looks a bit of a mess, but once you start putting the top coats over that and it all starts to blend away, all you'll see is just subtle gradients and variations in the undertones underneath. So, and yeah, whatever I don't like, whatever looks too heavy, you can just keep applying thin coats of the top coat until it disappears. So, moving on, we shall get started the base coat next. Base coat. First thing I'm going to use is this. It's like a mini spray gun. I think the brand was Sparmax, fairly inexpensive, about 90 quid. Do the job just fine. I don't need anything too expensive. Like I said earlier, I'm not creating fine art, I'm trying to sign my name or anything like that. I'm not making 80s metal band posters or electro album covers or nothing like that. So this will do the job. The reason I'm using this is because I need to get quite a lot of paint on this to cover it pretty well. I could use a standard airbrush, but it takes a little bit more work, and you know, the amount of passes that you have to go through because of the fan size of an airbrush, you end up with sort of a liney, streaky finish that you have to keep going over to get rid of. This will do the job very quickly because it sprays out a lot of paint in quite a wide fan. So once I've got a few coats of this with this, I'll swap over to a standard airbrush and carry on from there. So let's get this loaded up with paint and start making some mess.
Thank you.
Right, there you go. That's the first pass of the base coat down, the darker of the two base coats. It's not the pre-shading down a fair bit, but I'm going to do another coat in a couple of seconds once it's sort of flashed off a little bit. You can see where there's areas where this kind of where that sort of gun just, it's too broad a tool, you can't get into the nooks and crannies, so that's where I'll switch to a standard airbrush. But it's really good for getting a lot of volume of paint on really quick, and it looks like I'm hosing loads of paint on, and yes it is in some respects, but I've got this paint thinned quite a lot, so although it looks like there's a lot of material being thrown at the surface, it's very thin, so it's not building up very quickly, and that's what I want. I want good control on like the opacity of the coat, so I don't want to go putting too thick paint on there, because one, you'll get runs, and two, you haven't really got much control. You just sort of hose in the colour on, and it'll just block everything out real quick, and I don't want that. So let's give this a few more seconds to flash off, and I'll give it another run with the base coat. Right then, let's talk about detailing and Aztec in this thing. So what I've got here is Aztec Dummies mask set. Now this has been in production for years. Lou made this set, I don't know, 20 years ago, something like that, maybe even longer. And it's a very well used set. A lot of people have used it, and I will be using it, but I won't be using all of it. And the reason for that is because when Lou first designed this set, the refit reference that he had at his disposal isn't like what we've got today, you know, with all those high resolution Christie's auction photos and screen grabs from 4K discs and things like that. They just didn't exist back then. So on the whole, he's got a very, very accurate saucer mask pattern going on. So I'll be definitely using those. But the other areas, like the side of the secondary hull and the nacelles in particular, he's had to sort of go his own way with that. And it's his own interpretation with the pattern that he's given you to do that. So, and yes, they're good patterns, but they're not what I'm looking for this particular build. So I won't be using them. And that is not knocking this set, I will say that. There's nothing wrong with this set at all. It's just not the detail that I'm after for this particular build. If it was like just a sort of, yeah, make it look like the Enterprise, just give it some general detailing, I'd be using every single page of this set. But the brief is slightly different for this build, so I need to go a slightly different route. So I will be using some of these. But for all the other areas, like the secondary hull and the nacelles and the doors, the dorsal and pylons, etc., I'll be using my own masks. And also another reason for not using these is because I've done so many modifications on the secondary hull, these masks just wouldn't fit the grid lines anymore because they're not the stock kit grid lines. They're the ones that I've made. So that's very important to remember. Anyway, getting back to these. So if you've seen my other videos on my channel, you'll know I've got a vinyl cutter, and indeed I make my own masks, just not for this particular kit. I make it for the 1400 scale Enterprise D. So I'm very well versed in making paint masks, so why not use the kit that I've got to my disposal. Now I've just printed the sheet here so you can see it a little bit clearer. You can see I've got pylon masks there with Paul Olson's maddening inducing lightning bolt interlocking brickwork thing that he went crazy with on these pylons. Secondary hull side, secondary hull bottom, you know, all the rest of it. So I'll be using these masks to, and I'll be laying them down in whole sections at a time, and then picking out random tiles wherever I see fit and spraying different tones through those patterns, and then putting the tile back, removing another one, spray a different color, rinse and repeat, and building up loads of different patterns like that and color variations, etc. So I'll be using this. This isn't the only masking that I'll be making for this kit. I'm sure I'll be making some generic sort of tiling that looks something like this, but you know, you just sort of lay it over the finished design and then add even more detail over the top. The nacelles need their own masks, so I'll be doing those as well. So yeah, you're going to be seeing a bit of a mixture of masking methods and materials on this project. So in the end, we should get something that looks pretty much how it did in Star Trek 6. Well, that's the aim anyway. So let's get it turned over and I'll start on the bottom of the saucer and take it from there. Thank you. And there we go, that's the completed Saucer Aztec pattern, and you can see that there's plenty of tonal variations going on there, and it was pretty simple to achieve. So it's a very effective method. It works pretty well, so pleased with that. Now, for the rest of the ship, I used a slightly different method, and basically what I did was, using my own masks, start with the base coat, the darker of the two colours, apply a few masks, spray over that with a couple of very light passes of the lighter colour, apply a few more masks, spray again over that with just a couple of light passes of the lighter colour, apply a few more masks, and just repeat that process 4 or 5 times. Now, this method relies on using really thin paint, very, very thin paint. Basically, what that gives you is very gradual colour changes between each masking layer. And if you do that 4 or 5 times, when you remove all of the masks, what you get are 4 or 5 slightly different shades of grey. So there you go, effective technique, and it goes pretty quickly. So, and as you can see there, there's plenty of grey tones, and I only used 2 base coats to get all of those greys, so very effective. It looks pretty good, and you could probably leave it like that. There's plenty of detail in all the paint job. You can see all of the panels there and the subtle shade changes. But as a wise young hobbit once said, there's room for more. So I shall be adding some sort of secondary patterns of blues and sort of dirty greys to make that pattern even more random and detailed. So, but that'll do for this video. I'll cover that stuff in the next one, because this one's getting a bit long. So there we go. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in paint part 2.